Central Christian Church. We're going to start our morning out with some music. Russ and Greg are going to join me. We're going to start with Take My Life. So sing along if you would like. Our words will be right up on your screen. Going to be Alleluia, Sing to Jesus.
Thunder like a mighty flood. Even though we are far apart, we are together nonetheless in the Spirit. And we appreciate all of you joining us today. It's a little odd for us as we look out at empty pews, but we know that you are with us, and we thank you very much. The one announcement that I do need to make for our church life together, because we are still the church, whether we are gathered in this building or not, is that next week, as we normally do, we are collecting food for the food bank over at Burlington Elementary. And even though they are out of school, they are still providing food for their students, and we are providing backup for them. So if you are wanting to participate in that, we invite you to bring some food this week, during the week. Set it at the office door and ring the bell. And for social distancing, we'll wait till you've gone away, and then we'll come and collect that, and we will get it delivered as well. So we do appreciate all of that that we've got together. So we continue in our time of worship this morning, and we are looking at the spiritual disciplines as we have followed these through the season of Lent. And today's scripture lesson comes from the fifth chapter of the letter to the Hebrews. Hear now the word of God. Neither did Christ presume to set himself up as high priest, but was set apart by the one who said to him, "You are my son. Today I celebrate you. In another place, God declares, you are a priest forever in the royal order of Melchizedek. While he lived on earth, anticipating death, Jesus cried out in pain and wept in sorrow as he offered up priestly prayers to God. Because he honored God, God answered him. Though he was God's son, he learned trusting obedience by what he suffered, just as we do. Then, having arrived at the full stature of his maturity, and having been announced by God as high priest in the order of Melchizedek, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who believingly obey him. It's the word of God. Now, I hope that you have been practicing the disciplines as we've discussed them week by week. And if you have, then perhaps you have noticed that as the disciplines take us on a journey deeper and deeper into inner life with God, we also find that there is a corresponding narrowing of the exterior life. That is, when we come to love the inner work of God, we come to know the constriction of the outer life as well. As it is necessary to still the mind and body, to be present completely to the Lord, so there is a corresponding need to bring under control the appetites and drives and habits and tastes and trappings of our lifestyle. That is in order that we may learn a freedom that detaches us from the things that control us, even if those things happen subconsciously. We are dying at one level in order to be more alive at another. Think of it as a hot air balloon. Once the balloon is filled with air, or with breath, or with spirit, because all of those words are the same word in Scripture, once that balloon is inspired, the breath goes in, it is tethered to the ground. But in order for the balloon to do what it is intended to do, to be what it is intended to be, that is to soar freely into the sky, then those tethers must be released. Listen again to what the author of Hebrews says of Jesus. He writes, though he was God's son, he learned trusting obedience by what he suffered, just as we do. Then, having arrived at his full measure of maturity, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him. We are tethered to so many things that keep us from being free. Some of them are conscious, but many are subconscious. As the work of the Spirit goes on within us, the more we seek that freedom in Christ Jesus. Of course, the more we seek to be free, the more we realize that we are not free. The attachments, the tethers of our lives are many and strong. Now, Jesus, in essence, told his disciples that the things that you love will tell you who and what you are. Therefore, it was for them, as it is for us, necessary to root out all of these tethers in order for us to be free and to hear and to respond to God's word, as opposed to being subject to our own word and our own will. As we get in touch with these tethers, even or especially the secret ones, we find that our judgments, our choices, our decisions are heavily influenced by those very attachments, which oftentimes leaves us indifferent to God and to God's good pleasure for us and the world. Jesus spoke quite often to his disciples about the problem of divided loyalties and how they made it impossible to fully follow him. For instance, he said to the disciples one time, "You cannot serve both God and money. Either you'll love one and hate the other, or you will serve one and not the other." He told the parable of the soils, where the poor soil or the soil filled with weeds choke out the good seed. He said to the disciples another time, "When you put your hand to the plow, don't look back, because you can't plow a straight line looking behind you." And then he also said, "Leave the dead to bury the dead." That is, you cannot have divided loyalties. Like a house divided against itself, a person with divided loyalties will not be able to stand. Learning to conquer that divide is the terrain of discipleship, hence the disciplines. And perhaps nothing divides our loyalties so much as the need to be in control. I mean, think about how controlled our lives are. For society praises control. We are taught control, even from our youngest days. We say to our kids, "You can be anything you want. You have the control. You are in charge of your own destiny. Control." Or how many times have we heard our kids say, mimicking their parents, I suppose, "You're not the boss of me." And so when you get right down to it, most of our struggles with others are all about control, being in charge, fighting against someone else being the boss of you. Naturally, we don't often put that name on it. The names we usually select are much more noble sounding. We convince ourselves that what is at stake are much deeper meanings, and that whatever the endeavor, without our guidance and direction, it is certainly doomed to failure. And the same is true in church. I have been witness to many church arguments and even splits where the issue comes down to the question of control. And in the same way as our personal lives, we convince ourselves that we are fighting somehow for eternal spiritual principles and that it's important that we win and get our way. But does it really matter for salvation and the world's sake what color the carpeting is? Or whether we sit in pews or chairs? Or what hymnal that we sing out of? When I was pastoring Oak Grove Church in Georgia, we had a major fundraiser every year, the Oak Grove Country Fair. And like our own book sale, the fair made up about half of the church's yearly income, an annual budget. And what ended up destroying that fair and consuming many of the church members in the process was a battle about control. Would charity get a piece, or would all the money go to the church? Who decides? And if charities get a benefit, who gets to decide which charities? And who presents the check? Were the funds to be earmarked for specific purposes or general use? And the fight went on because the family that owned the property on which the fair was held felt that those choices should be theirs to make, whereas others felt that the congregation's board should direct distribution. And eventually, not being able to reach a decision, it fell apart. Control. Now, the discipline of submission is probably the least understood and most distorted of the spiritual disciplines. When you submit in a spiritual practice, it frees you to value what God wants and what God wants from you, and it leaves you open to the dreams and the moods and the plans of other people. It allows people to not always need to get their own way. Sometimes we fail to recognize the toll that being in control takes on our emotions, on our health, and on our relationships. Submission frees us to be followers. And if we happen to be asked to lead by the community, then we know we are ready to lead as servants and not as rulers. The Gospel of Mark tells us that whoever would follow Jesus must first deny themselves. And that's the hard part. Deny themselves and then take up the cross and follow Jesus. Submission, of course, has its limits when practiced with integrity. Submission is not merely giving in or going along just to avoid a conflict. For instance, there is the law of love. If submission interferes with your love of God or your neighbor, then it is not spiritual submission. Or we know that Paul, for instance, urged submission to the governing authority. In his letter to the Romans, he said to do that. And governing authorities have used that ever since. But Paul also insisted that those same authorities' injustices must be righted. They could not go on. What your submission does is make space for others. It allows that you don't know everything or see every angle, and that the contribution of another person or other group is valuable. You will learn that the reward for self-denial is not the loss of your identity, as we so often worry. It is instead a rewarding awareness of others, of the beloved community. So all of you who have ears to hear, let them hear. Our time of prayer. And as our prayer hymn is being done, Blessed Assurance, by our praise group, then I hope that you will take a moment, that if you have someone that you would like us to mention in prayer, please go ahead and send those in Facebook. I'll be monitoring those and writing them down. So it's helpful, instead of giving me a long list, if you'll just leave me a name. I will like that, and then we will pray together. Blessed Assurance.
Blessed Assurance. Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchased of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His. Angels descend.
Thank you, folks. We go into our time of prayer today. We have had several requests, and so we do want to remember all of these folks are the ones we generally remember. We want to continue them in our prayers, even though we don't mention them week by week. Carol Baxter, Miles Riesinger, Leanne Story, Lexi Wagner, those who suffer from addictions. We also have requests for family and friends of Jack Brueggemann, who passed away this last Friday evening. We want to remember them. Also, remember all of those who are affected by the coronavirus, COVID-19. Remember the healthcare workers who are on the front lines of that that battle, continue to work during this very scary crisis, and that we continue to work towards curing and getting over this virus. So we need to remember all of those people in that way. So we'll take a few moments in silence. And then we will pray together. Let's pray. It is in the silence and in the midst of our lives that, O Lord, you come to us, your Holy Spirit whispering, and we hear you. We lift to you all those people that we have named this day, those that we have named out loud, those that we have named in the silence of our heart. You know their needs, even before we have mentioned them. And for that, we give you thanks. Lord, your Spirit is teaching us what the Spirit is, what the church is. For though we are sheltered safe in our homes, we are nonetheless together. If we but listen and feel, we know the bond that ties us to one another. And so we give you thanks. Bless us in our worship. Bless us in our service. Bless us in all of our comings and goings as we do so in your name. And we pray together the prayer that you taught us so long ago. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive others. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We go now into our time of communion. And we are calling this time now the Feast of Love or Comfort Food. And so we will bless the food. So wherever you are, I invite you to go to the kitchen and get another cup of coffee or a drink, some of your favorite comfort food. And we will share that together and bless it as we continue in worship. Give thanks. When we break bread together as the church, as we do in our worship, we remember that Jesus invited folks to come to the table, not just as part of his ministry, not just as the Last Supper, but all the time. And so we have created this way to break bread together in our homes. And as you share in that at home, remember all those that you share it with. Today we talked about submission. And at this table, as we gather about it, we remember that It is inscribed, "Do this in remembrance of me." In other words, we submit to the memory of Jesus Christ. And so I invite you to take a few moments and consider that. Consider that as Jesus prepared the banquet, he invited all people to come from the highways and the byways to gather together to eat around the table. It is difficult in this moment not to be near some of the people that we love and might be worried about. Take a moment and say out loud the prayers of people that you wish were right there next to you at your table today. Jesus is no longer physically on earth. Yet every time we gather together around the table, we call him to mind. He is present with us in the spirit, and so too our loved ones are with us. Let this be a comfort to us. We also want to call to mind the people we cannot name, those whose names we do not know, but we know that they need our prayers and God's comfort. So remember those who have lost loved ones, and for those who are sick and recovering, for those who are caring for loved ones who are sick at home, for those who are caring for persons in medical care, for those who are separated from loved ones, for those who are feeling alone and isolated, for those who are helping and are so very tired, for those who are struggling to find friends, to find food, to find comfort, and for those who are afraid. I invite you to take for a moment a deep breath on behalf of all of those we do not know and cannot call by name. As we do so, we know that God knows who needs our prayers and the Spirit. Breath of God is blowing from within us outward as Spirit of compassion and presence. Blessings at the table are a part of our Judeo-Christian heritage. Indeed, Jesus adapted his Jewish ritual, blessing spoken before and after meals. And he asked us to remember him whenever we break bread and raise a cup of thanksgiving. This is why we call our communion prayers the Great Thanksgiving. In this feast of love and comfort, we can call to mind things for which we are deeply grateful. I invite you to speak aloud a couple of things that you are grateful for in this moment. And so I invite you to raise a plate of something on your table or a glass of whatever you are drinking and let us bless it in this way. Please repeat after me there at home. Holy Comforter, we gather in your name. Invited by Jesus, bound together with your Spirit, in union with each other. Feed our bodies and our spirits with your comforting presence, so that we might be your comfort to others. Bless this food and break open our hearts. Bless this drink and pour out your love. Amen. And as you pass and fill your plates out there, I hope and invite you to imagine the extravagant love looks like as you reach across the social distances to loved ones, to friends, and even to acquaintances or strangers. And now, may you shelter not only in place, but in peace. May the peace and comfort of Christ be present with you now and forevermore. Amen. And I invite you to join with me as we close with our blessing. It will be printed for you. Holy God, through the discipline of these 40 days, make your Spirit's cleansing fire burn within us. Lift us from the dying embers of our inattention. Mark us with the signs of your holy passion. Make us ready to respond to the call of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's close with sanctuary.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true.
Amen.